Oh, she is changing. Bing, bing,
yeah, yeah,
bing, bing.
Yeah. That's a spike.
Yeah.
So, Hans Georg.
Okay, good afternoon. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, and special guests to the Saxon Ring in Germany, where it is the privilege of Dorna Sports CEO Carmelo Espeleta to induct Hans-Georg Anscheid into the Hall of Fame as a MotoGP legend. I'm also delighted to welcome Hans-Georg's son, Ahim, I'm sure on what is a very special day for generations of the Anscheid family, many who've come from all four corners of the world today. Ahim, great to see you as well.
Thank you,
welcome to all three of you gentlemen. Now, before we celebrate Hans-Georg's becoming the 38th rider to take his place in an exclusive list and iconic names in the MotoGP Hall of Fame, let's watch this special video looking back on the career of one of the most successful Grand Prix riders of the 1960s. Wonderful images there, which I'm sure evoke great memories. Carmelo, MotoGP is always extremely proud to celebrate its great history and recognise the achievements of riders who contributed so much to Grand Prix racing. So I'm sure today is a special occasion for you and Dorna to welcome Hans-Georg as a MotoGP legend.
Well, thank you very much. It's as you said, a special pleasure for me to nominate today Hans-Georg Anscheid, member of the Hall of Fame of MotoGP. And I was telling to his son, I am especially happy because I have the opportunity to see him racing in Spain, in the circuit of Montjuic, in Barcelona, in the year, I think, 63-64. I was starting my feeling with the bikes, and I remember very well the sound of the Suzuki with a lot of gearbox changing the situation. Then was a special moment, and I remember very well. He has been a very successful rider, and it's a big honor for us to receive him, a member of the Hall of Fame of MotoGP.
Hans-Georg, before we invite you to say a few words, I'd just like to take this opportunity to say a few words about your great career. Born in 1935, Hans-Georg raced in Enduro and Speedway in the 1950s before switching to road racing in 1960 on 50cc machines that he would make his name. His name will go down in history as Hans-Georg won the first 50cc World Championship Grand Prix at the legendary Montjuic Park, as Carmelo mentioned, riding a Kreidler machine. In 1962, 63 and 64, he finished inside the top three in the World Championship. He then moved to Suzuki, where he enjoyed fantastic success and was crowned 50cc World Champion 3 years in a row from 1966 to 1968. His last title in 1968 came as a privateer, and the Suzuki KR67, which he won his last titles on, is here today as part of this wonderful exhibition. This bike bike is truly unique, as it is the one and only model of its kind left in the world today. As Carmelo said, incredibly, this bike with a 14-speed gearbox was capable of a top speed of 205 kilometers an hour, despite only producing around 18 horsepower. Incredible achievements for Hans Georg. He was also a European champion and an 11 times German champion as well in the 50cc and 125cc classes. What a fantastic career. Congratulations, Hans Georg, on this very special honor. If you could please say a few words in German, and then we'll ask your son, Achim, to translate for his English. So the stage is yours.
Deutsch.
Das ist?
Du solltest ein paar Worte sagen, so wie das angedacht war.
So.
Was es für dich bedeutet und so weiter.
Ja. Also, ich habe 1960 angefangen und damals fing 50 Kubik an und die Motorräder fuhren 100 Kilometer schnell. Das waren.
When he started his career, this was in the beginning of the 1960s, it was a very fresh series of races, it was called European GP or European races. The motorcycles were really like mopeds, racing mopeds, and they were going maximum 100 kilometers an hour.
Und 1961 begann zum ersten Mal international und es wurde eine Europameisterschaft ausgeschrieben.
And then 61, everything turned into more serious road racing with the European Championships.
Gleichzeitig war in Deutschland die deutsche Meisterschaft ausgeschrieben.
And at the same time, German Championships in the same year.
So. Und ich war Werksfahrer von Kreidler von 1960 bis 1965.
After beginning his career, early stage races in dirt track racing and off-road racing, he scored a contract with the Kreidler factory, the Kreidler works around Stuttgart, and became a factory rider, but also a test rider for the company, right? From 1961 until 1964. And if I remember correctly, he became second in the championship in the years 1962 and 63.
In dieser Zeit habe ich nicht nur Straßenrennen gefahren, sondern auch Six Days, also zwei Sechstagefahrten, die ich beide für Kreidler gewinnen konnte. Das war 1960 in Österreich und 1961 in England.
In this time, and this might be a bit unconventional to all of you in today's standards, he was employed by Kreidler, the Kreidler factory, and racing street races. But at the same time, he was also racing off-road races and 6 days trial and 6 days enduro. So this was the nature and the spirit, I guess, of those days.
Good. Kreidler hörte auf mit Rennen. Also man hatte keine Weltmeisterschaft gewonnen. Und es schwank, oder man hatte keine Lust mehr, Straßenrennen zu fahren.
So we come now slowly to the mid-1960s, and actually the German factory Kreidler had to realize against mainly Suzuki and Honda that they were not standing really a chance anymore, and they then decided to stop or slow down with factory racing.
Ich war bei einem kleinen Rennen in Belgien, und es kam ein noch kleiner wie ich, ein kleiner Japaner, auf mich zugelaufen und hat mir ein Telegramm gegeben und hat gesagt, very careful, ganz so.
I think you could consider this an early adventure of headhunting in those days, motorcycle days. A very secretive Japanese person approached him from the background and put a telegram into his hand to silently contact the Suzuki factory in Hamamatsu.
So, ich habe mit dem Herrn Kreidler, den ich in 6 Jahren einmal gesehen habe, der lebte in der Schweiz, einen Brief geschrieben. Kreidler möchte nicht mehr fahren. ob ich freigestellt werde für Suzuki. Und Suzuki möchte, dass ich den letzten Grand Prix in Japan 1965 für Suzuki fahre.
So, for those of you who don't know, Mr. Kreidler was a very, very private man in the 60s. He was never really to be seen, only came to the factory at night. He was a bit of a Howard Hughes of those early days, I would say. And my father wrote to him a personal letter saying, can you please excuse me from my Kreidler contract for the rest of the year? I have a chance to ride for Suzuki and have a test ride, so to say. If you would just please let me go for this one race. And Mr. Kreidler said, yeah, of course, please do it, and good luck for that.
Dann begann Suzuki Zeit.
Then Suzuki time started.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Ich war dann sehr erfolgreich, oder ich hatte viel Erfolg mit Suzuki, mit 50 Kubik und 125. Aber 125 hat Suzuki immer gesagt, Hans Hansken. Ich war der Name Hans Hansken. 125 war Huey Anderson, Frank Perez, Katayama, Hansken only, please, 50cc.
As naturally, my father is of very small stature and very little height. He was always destined to race less the 125cc class, more the 50cc class. But then you have to keep in mind the 50cc class was very challenging in terms of the technical development. Probably what you have seen in the 90s about Group B rally development, that technology got so exotic that only Suzuki and Honda were able really to produce this kind of technology. Most of this motorcycle is out of titanium, the frame is out of aluminium, a two-cylinder bike, it has a 14-speed gearbox and only a reference, a usable reference between 17,500 and 18,000. So that's why doing 50cc racing at the time really escalated in this, let's say, friendly, semi-friendly war between Honda and Suzuki. What was the end result of this? That privateers could not really compete anymore. Or so, it was a bit more than you said.
Right, good spokesman. Right.
Okay, yeah. Ich war dann von 65 to 68 Suzuki. Leider, und ja, ich war 9-mal deutscher Meister, 3-mal Weltmeister, das ist aber ja bekannt. Ne? Okay. So. Und 1965?
Ja.
Ja. 67. Mhm. 67 sagte Suzuki, wir stoppen. Also wir möchten 68 nicht mehr fahren. Mhm.
So he had a chance to become world champion then on a Suzuki two-stroke, two-cylinder bike in 66 and 67. But then actually Suzuki already had decided, so did Honda, by the way, to withdraw from the competition because they said this is not leading anywhere. And then the FIM, if I remember correctly at that time, changed it all to one cylinder and a six-speed gearbox. So my father asked nicely if he could have one motorcycle from Suzuki and spare parts, which you see here. This is an original 1960s Suzuki box from Hamamatsu with spare parts of the time. If he could have one motorcycle, and Suzuki granted him, which is unusual. Normally, all the bikes go back to Suzuki and they get trashed completely. So this was unusual that he got this bike, and this was a very special one. This was raced by Katayama in 67, if I remember correctly, and had a really terrible accident, went back to Japan, they repaired it there, and decided to give it to my father to race it in the 68 season to become, as a privateer, world champion one more time. And that's why this is the only one left of its time, because it's the only one where the whole engine is almost 100 millimeter higher in the chassis than all the other bikes to get more air underneath the aerodynamic value.
Gentlemen, I think it is now time for the most important part.
Oh, wait, Matt.
Of course, go for it. No, please, please.
Du wolltest noch Danke sagen, dass keine Familie da ist.
Ja. Ja. Ja, ich, ich bin sehr dankbar für die Donna und für die Chefs und dass ich hier sein durfte, dass ich diese Ehrung entgegennehmen durfte und dass ich meine Familie, die da ist, einladen konnte. Dafür bin ich Dankeschön.
Thank you for the whole family being here. Thank you, Carmelo. Thank you, Ignacio. Thank you, Imre, for also making this happening. Thank you, Matt, for the introduction. Thank you for the whole Donna stuff to bring us here and give us a home and also welcome us into this presentation. Thank you very much.
Und ebenfalls bin ich sehr dankbar für Imre Paulowitz, der das alles in die Wege geleitet hat und dem ich das alles zu verdanken habe.
Yes. And a very special thanks to Imre Paulowitz, the walking dictionary of motorcycle racing, having made this possible.
Gentlemen, it's been an absolute pleasure to welcome you and your family here today for this special ceremony. I'd now please like Carmelo to hand over the special medal to Hans-Georg, and then we can then place his name in the Hall of Fame. Carmelo, if you could do the honors with the medal, thank you very much.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. Mille grazie.
If we can now get the special photo put onto the Hall of Fame. Thanks to you, to Carmelo, and to Hans-Georg.
Ciao.
You need the same.
Yeah.
He speaks fantastic Italian as well. Congratulations once again to Hans-Georg on joining the Elite Club as a MotoGP legend. Carmelo, many thanks for your attendance today. We'll ask you to leave the stage now. If I can ask Hans-Georg and Haim, please, to remain in your seats. If, gentlemen, you'd like to take a seat once again. And I will now invite the assembled media to ask their questions first in English, please. Do we have any questions from our international media friends?
Simon. Yeah, hi, Adam Wheeler. Two small questions. First one, Hans-Georg, do you still watch MotoGP now? What do you think of it? And the second one, if I heard correctly, your first win was in Montjuic. Can you tell us what you remember of this circuit? Was it as dangerous as it was beautiful?
Okay, die erste Frage war, ob du noch MotoGP am Fernsehen verfolgst oder was da vor sich geht gerade. Und die zweite Frage ist, ob du dich an Montjuic erinnerst in Barcelona oder was für Erinnerungen du daran hast?
Okay, ich muss leider sagen, ich bin nicht auf dem Laufenden, wer in MotoGP vom Motorrad oder von den Fahrern das Beste ist oder wer am meisten gewinnt.
He's not so much following anymore right now and staying up to date with the whole MotoGP world, I have to admit.
Von Barcelona weiß ich genau, ich war der erste 50-Kubik-Fahrer, der Montjuïc gewonnen hat. 1962 war der erste WM-Lauf für 50 Kubik. Das habe ich gewonnen und ich habe, glaube ich, 4 oder 5 Mal Montjuïc gewonnen mit Kreidler und Suzuki.
So, what I wanted to add to the first sentence is that despite that not following so closely, but when we see something about MotoGP, we're actually always blown away what's going on in today's world of motorcycle racing and how exotic it becomes. And in contrast to a lot of Formula One races, actually the races of MotoGP are quite exciting, I have to say. We have to say. Montjuic was really favorable for my dad in terms of having won a first 50cc race as well. And even though there was always very, very strong local competition in Barcelona, if we remember, he had a chance to be victorious there a couple of times. And he remembers the circuit quite nice because it has a lot of up and down. It's quite an intriguing circuit, a lot of long up uphill and then in a lot of twirls downwards. So it's good memories that come with Montjuic, and actually it's really nice to actually drive on the track in Barcelona today and see what it felt like these days.
Okay, ich bin dankbar für alles, was ich erleben durfte.
Wait, there are more questions. Wait. Noch mehr Fragen.
Yeah. Yes, so I have a question for you, Hans. I've got more than one, but just answer it how you would like. To give us a picture I love to hear from this era, can you tell me who were your opponents that you admired at the time you were racing? The second part is the circuit that you loved the most from back then, and the final part, the result that you're most proud of, the race result.
Also this is Simon Crafer, as auch MotoGP Gewinner in früheren Zeiten. Ja. So, fragt, was war dein größter Wettbewerb in der damaligen, wer war der größte Wettbewerber in der damaligen Zeit? Was war deine Lieblingsrennstrecke und deine Lieblingserinnerung aus den 60ern?
Well, ich habe Barcelona 4 oder 5 Mal gewonnen. Natürlich war das eine Lieblingsstrecke von mir. Und meine größten Konkurrenten waren mit Sicherheit Luigi Taveri mit der Honda und Huey Anderson in meinem Suzuki-Team und auch Katayama, ebenfalls Suzuki-Team. Wir hatten also untereinander eine große Konkurrenz und ein hartes Wettbewerb. Aber ich hab sehr gern Straßenrennen gefahren, also Deutsche Meisterschaft, Weltmeisterschaft, Europameisterschaft. Aber was mir auch sehr am Herzen lag, Geländesport, also International Six Days Trial mit Kreidler. Ich konnte 2-mal die 6-Tage-Fahrt in Austria 1960 und 1961 in England gewinnen.
So, I think the biggest opponents or the most favorite Grand Prix seems to be Barcelona, really, with Montjuic, therefore, hence a good first question. Main opponents were Luigi Taveri with Honda, and then two of his team colleagues, Hideo Katayama, I think, was his first name, and Huey Anderson of the same team. I think his favorite thing to say about the 60s or maybe about motorcycle GP riding of his time was that he always had a love and a passion for off-road riding, for enduro riding, motocross. And I still think this is today, he always says, is today a good general base education if you are a dirt track rider or motocross rider, and then to switch to street racing is always a good education in terms of bike handling, no?
Another question here, Hans-Georg. How was it to ride this bike? Can you explain us the riding technique and what was difficult? What did you enjoy most? Please. Dankeschön.
Wie war es, dieses Motorrad zu fahren? Was war am schwierigsten und was hast du am meisten genossen?
Well, the top speed was nearly 180 kilometers. Wow, 180 Kilometer.
Mm-hmm. And you can also speak in English if you want.
Mein Fahrerlager Englisch ist nicht gut. Difficult, also schwierig war natürlich die vielen Gänge. In Spa zum Beispiel, wenn wir von unten hochkamen zu dem Spitzeck. Wir hatten einen Bremsweg von 100 Meter. Wir müssten bremsen bei 100 Meter, aber wir müssten 13 Gänge zurückschalten, damit wir wieder beschleunigen konnten. Und bei der Übersetzung, bei den Sprockets in Belgien, in Spa, da ging der erste Gang auf 120 km/h. Und dann waren die anderen Gänge natürlich für bergab nearly 200. Ne? Und das viele technische Mitdenken mit dem Motorrad, das war sehr schwierig. Also. Und man musste ja auch noch fahren. Und die Reifen, die waren eigentlich auch nur ein bisschen. Also man fing nicht an, in der Kurve zu rutschen, wo man merkte, das ist das Ende jetzt, sondern das ging weg.
You need a translation for this?
Yeah, very, very well. The biggest challenge really to ride this motorcycle, I think, was about the gearbox. For example, let's take Spa in Belgium. The first gear was translated from 0 to 110, 120. And then all the other 13 were going towards 200 and 205. So when you would go on the endless straight in Spa and then you would hit, you have to shift down 13 times and lean the bike over and then shift all the 14 gears up again. So it was the challenge of riding this bike was really a technical one, a technical expertise and also developing this bike. Everything became so fragile and delicate and pinpointed to, you know, driving a bicycle, a motorcycle between 17,500 and 18,000 rev range was extremely challenging, I would say. No? And then about, in contrast to today's time, right, I almost forgot, when you look at the tires here, this was not a matter of sliding in any way. There was no slide whatsoever. It was only either no slide or off, so to say. Yeah.
Und dann hatten wir auch nur einen Reifen. Kalt,
oh,
und warm, nass.
Only
und
one tire. No, yeah. Nothing about a slick or anything. There was only one tire for wet, dry, intermediate, or whatever it was.
Such wonderful memories. Ahim, thanks for your help with your father today on this special occasion for your family. That concludes today's ceremony, ladies and gentlemen. Our thanks, as always, to Dorna CEO Carmelo Spalletta. But if you can please show your appreciation one more time for new MotoGP legend Hans Georg Henschel.
Thank you. Come on, we can. Yeah, come over here. Yeah. Mama. Oh, alle? Alle rauf? Alle rauf?
Jo. Ja, okay.
Ja, ja.
Ja, ja.
Ja, ja, come. Those are very special friends of ours. They are practically family, so they belong to the family picture.
Alter Grosche.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Carmelo.
Thank you.
Mutter. Finger weg.
Herzlichen Glückwunsch.
Danke.
Ich habe das gut gefunden.